Hi everyone, and I'm Shivashis, and I am a fourth year engineering undergrad. I major CS, and I've been working for the past couple of months on a project called Mission Support System. It involves maps. It's for atmospheric scientists, so they plot their work. So they plot the flight paths which they take for the atmospheric research. It can be used for oceanographic scientists as well, but more on that later. And let's start with the talk. I'll be talking on this topic, and I'll be talking about parts of each of these words over the other set of slides. So let's get started. What is common among the products listed below? The first one is ArcGIS, then Uber, and then Google Maps. Clearly this one is quite obvious. They're maps, right? But of course we won't be talking about 2D paper maps. They're pretty cool, but we won't be talking since we can't use Python on that. We'll be talking digital maps. Digital maps are pretty cool. For the last decade they have been used extensively for visualizations and for research purposes as well, because you see scientists for which the data they involve geography, it's quite easier to visualize if you present them in a map. So what is geographic information system? It's something a system or a technology stack which we use to add, modify, or use things that involve geographic or geospatiality, right? So all the stack this is called geographic information system. And maps, how are they generated? Like for example, when you've used Google Maps from 10 different places and 10 different zoom levels, you get different maps, right? It's not like paper 2D map, and you don't get a map and they don't cut layers from it and give it to you. They generate this map dynamically every time you request for a map. So, and also, what is the need to separate maps and map servers? Like, why not they just give you one map or 1,000 different maps and ask you to plot the data yourself? You can do that, but sometime or the other you'll run out of your memory or your processing power to render the map. So it's better to keep them separated, and there's a map server which serves this map. They if you want, they can collect all your data, and then while rendering they can give it back to you. That's easy, right? Also for this talk we'll be taking an HTTP connection, and the web map server and the map client will be connected by an HTTP interface. That's how the standards are defined, which I'll be talking about sometime down the line. And okay, since you have an idea about the talk it is about, now let's talk about what will I cover. The first one, basic geography, or the primer for to understand all of these stuff, even if you're new to this. And creating maps. To serve web map servers, you have to create the maps first. I'll be talking about how to create maps and how do you store or manipulate the geodata which you use to create the maps. And of course, at the end, web map server, how to put it all together. And this talk will not be about commercial usage of maps or the scale. So that's all. Let's get started. Yeah. So first of all, we'll talk about, this is a list of the topic we'll be talking about when we talk about primer. And first of all, projections. And before that, look at this URL. And this is the final thing which you have to develop. Yeah. To get a map, you have to, show your server in an interface like this. I'll be going to this link, and I think it's visible. Give it some time. Yeah. So this is the map you get. This is the standard for everything. This is just a PNG image. You'll go to this link later. You'll see something like this. So now let's get back to the slides and talk about what are the features they are. I'm sorry. So yeah, what are the stuff you need to care about? So look at stuff like the service is WMS, that is web map service. There are a ton of different service, but this is the simplest one, or you can understand this better. And request, look at the request. It's get map for this instance. And B box is the bounding box, which you put two different coordinates, or one coordinate and the width and height. That's a different type of request. But and also SRS is spatial reference system. I'll be talking about everything, but first I need you to understand why I'll be talking about them. And layers are blue marble in cities. I'll be talking about layers too. And we can ignore style and format for now. Yeah, format, this image format, you can get other formats as well. So Yeah, so now you know what are we going to talk about and why, because all of these are necessary to generate the map. Map projections. Map projections try to portray the surface of the earth or a portion of earth on a flat piece of paper or computer screen. What is this? So earth is geoid in shape, right? And there are not, when I mean, it's easier for us to put it in a paper or to print it and then do stuff on it, right? So to generate maps, we need to first of all project the surface on a piece of paper. So look at how we can do it. So in the first example, you there's a light inside, and the light projects out, and each time it hits the second surface after the sphere, that's the plot of the geographic, you know, coordinate on the paper. And you roll out the paper, you get a map. But and there are other ways to do it as well. The second one involves a cone, and the third one involves two 2D sheets of circle on the top and bottom. So there's a flaw with it. Not one, many flaws with it. We'll talk about distortions. Yeah. So think about this. There's a patch in the equator, and then when the projection is received in the cylindrical surface, it will be more or less same, right? I mean, the area would be same, but in the same time, imagine something which is on the pole, yeah. And then the projection would be, I mean, it would be a cos theta component for the breadth and sine for the height. So it will be elongated. I mean, that's why the common thing which we see, the Russia is quite smaller than its area, or it's a different shape. So these are distortions, and exactly why we should care about coordinate reference system. So coordinate reference system then defines, with the help of these coordinates, how the two-dimensional projected map in your GIS is related to real places on Earth. So for now, I'll just say that each coordinate system, it defines the map projection, and we'll see why. Look at the maps of United States. In all of these maps, different coordinate reference system are used, or they're all different projections. And you can tell that the area of some states or distances between two places, they cannot be, you know, nothing is standard. So you just cannot go measure the distance and multiply it by the units of this map. You cannot do that. So that's why you keep track of coordinate reference system. If you know how you made the map, you know how to calculate area, you know how to get the distance between two places. So, and also this is generally done in a way that the projections are made to keep one thing constant. I mean, these are the four major things in which distortions can arise. And the projections are generally, they make one thing constant and change the three things. But all of these changes can be later fixed or compensated by your calculations which you do with reference to coordinate reference system. Next we move to layers. So why layers? Okay, what are layers? Layers are different semantic segments which or different types of data which can be represented by a map. For example, yeah, basically, let's say this is a hall, right? We can for our convenience, we can consider people as one layer and the chairs as another. Why? Because you see, okay, this is a 2.5D world, and we part it to three different layers. The first one is vegetation data, then buildings, and then street. If we combine all of these into one map, it's fine for three. What about if there are like hundreds and thousands of layers? Because there will be. So you cannot all press them into one page and give it to them, or one image. So that's why layers are defined. Also, they make it easy to query stuff. For example, okay, I'll talk about querying stuff within a layer later. Now, types of views. So the definition is self-explanatory. Like, you have some data, how do you view it? The one which we already know, it 2D view, the top view, we go to the top, a helicopter view of the place. And the second one, which is, okay, this is a better example. So that's from a game, I don't know where, but yeah, it's a 2D map, a helicopter which sees from the surface. And this one is a mobile RPG, a typical mobile RPG game where the dungeon is viewed when we cut the surface of the earth. So this is called a side view, and this is used to visualize, say, the data in a 2D shape in an ocean or atmosphere, anywhere. So we'll be talking about these two. And legend image is something which you use to define all the, you know, shortcuts you've used in your map. So that's about it. That's about all the terms you need to know to understand the rest of the talk. Let's now take a short detour to understand custom maps. And now we'll be talking about how to build maps. Before that, how do you get the data, or how do you keep the data? So there are two major types we'll be talking about. Well, yesterday Anand talked, the first talk we had, Anand talked about vector data. So, and not because of that, but we'll be talking a lot about raster here. But still, before that, raster is something which, let's say you have an n-dimensional image, then each, I mean, your unit power n area or space would be storing equal amount of data. For example, in here, you see all of the coordinates, they store one integer, which in this case, yeah, they represent the g value of the image. And each grid represents a data point. And the examples, I mean, or the sum, I mean, okay, they're stored in forms of netcdf, geotiff, there are others, but we'll be talking about netcdf a lot. And vector data. Vector data, they're used used to work on map. For example, they're mostly used to draw shapes on map, or they're mainly 2D. We don't use vector data in 3D maps or 3D to represent 3D data. So, yeah, so they are stored in the form of shapefile or GeoJSON. The vertices are stored in, or there are points and, yeah, markers as well. They can also be stored as vectors. Okay, let's not talk about NetCDF. I talked this raster format of data, right? So, okay, what are the complexities? Why do we need NetCDF in the first place? So, think about this. You have a 2D image, or you store 2D data in the form of CSV, and latitudes are rows and longitudes are column. And when you introduce another factor, let's say time, then you have to copy the whole series beneath the CSV. And when you need more dimensions, you index the CSV. And when you need more, you create directories like indices. So that's messy. You don't do that. Okay, you use NetCDF. NetCDF can store. Okay, the parts of NetCDF which we need to know are, there are variables and dimensions. So dimensions, they are variables in which your real data will vary. Like XYZ here, your data will vary according to the variables. And those variables are called dimensions. We'll know more about it during the demo. And variables are normal variables like, say, temperature, pressure, whatever you need to represent in a map. That's called a variable. Okay, the file is identify NC extension. And okay, you don't have to do that here. I'll be demoing this, but Mera2 is a data set provided by NASA. They have variables such as temperature, pressure, and lot of things. But for this demo, we'll use the temperature at 2 meter data, and I'll be demoing this shortly. But before that, I'll be talking about base map. So base map is this API which you use to draw a map. And how do we draw that? So I've talked about projections and background, right? The demo which I'll show you, it will take your input as to what projection to use. The backgrounds can be like the terrain or the sensors image, many types of that. Then they will take your input. Sorry, base map will take your input, and there are easy APIs to draw oceans, continents, labels. If I tell you how to generate maps from your custom data, you will later know that all of these stuff can be broken down to the same thing which I'll tell you. And the data plot can be done by contour or plot contour. There are curves and plot. You can plot points or shape files. A lot of stuff you can do with plot. And I'll be using color, but yeah. And base map is deprecated, and they are moving in favor of CartoPy. But I'll ask you to check it out. They don't fully support all the coordinate reference system yet, but still, that's the stuff. Okay, now let's talk about the demo. Let's try to plot data on a map. Before that, I'll do the NC view demo. Okay. Okay, this is the interface of NC view. NC view was developed by some other scientists. So this is what I was talking about. It infers some value by default from the NetCDF file and plots the data. So this way you can quickly view the NetCDF file. So okay, now let's talk about some stuff. So this is the code used to plot the Mera2 data set on a map. So first of all, this is the data I loaded. I extract longitudes and latitudes, and T2M, okay, I don't know why I did this, but yeah. So it extracts all the, it's a 3D data set, and okay, here, check this. Projection is ECK4, right? I'll do this with a different projection as well. That's where it takes your projection. Lat 0, long 0 at the center of the map. Yeah. And then I make a mesh grid with lat long, and I map the line 13. It converts your latitude and longitude to x and y. These are the coordinates in your CRS or local to this map which you're drawing. And yeah, so this is the important line, line 17. I color, I take x and y coordinate as the first, second parameters. This is the latitude and longitude. And this thing which you see here, this is a 2D array. You have to make sure this will be a 2D array. We'll take another data set and draw a plot where you will see that your data can have different, like I said, there can be 6, 7, 10 dimensions to an HCDF file, right? So you have to make sure this will be a 2D array. And these are Vmin and Vmax are your min and max values. And Cmap is used to do the colors. We'll see this. And like I said, draw parallels and meridians, they're used to draw the latitudes and longitudes in the side of the map. So yeah, the C bar is the color bar. So you have used Cmap to color the map, and you want a reference or something, you add a C bar. Okay, we can run this file here. Okay, in the meanwhile, this is the map you get, and all this stuff are what I talked about. This is the NCK4, coordinate reference system, and you see all the data. This is explanatory that, in the equator, it's kind of hot, and the top and bottom is kind of cold. And yeah, this data is temperature data, T2M, that stands for temperature at 2 meters. And okay. So this is another data set, and look at this. It is a 4D data set in which time is another variable. So see, this is where I take time equal to 0, and I take everything else. There are three other dimensions, but from which I'm taking the average of pressure. X is 0 was the pressure, so I take average of them. And this is now AP data. Now, the point where I said you have to make this a 2D array is np.squeeze AP. There was a single list of single elements, so I had to squeeze that. But yeah, so this is where you have to make the change. Just make sure you plot the right data when you are given many dimensions. And rest of the stuff remains same. And the name, the plot title, that's different, but. Okay, the data we had was only to that area. We didn't do anything else here. It smartly plots everything. So that's about how to make a map from data. Now look at this. We added our custom layers into this, right? And when the maps are generated, if you have points, as in this is a land, this is not a land, this is sea. So that's how you generate like kind of maps which are drawn inside, or the gray maps. So this is how you draw it. If you have data, you can straight out plot it and you get the map. And you want to add layers, you add layers. And yeah, that was my point. If you have any kind of 3D data, you make it to 2D in which you can plot in a paper, you use these tools, you make a map. Let's go back to the slides. Okay, this is something I told you, pressure data set for the world map. And yeah, I explained how is the map created, the map as in here, the gray and white, or black and white. Okay, so that's done. We know now how to create a map. Now let's talk about WMS, the title of the talk. It's termed WMS server, and there are standards, but why? Okay, there are about, there are like hundreds of WMAP servers, and same, hundreds of WMAP clients, and you need to make sure both of them understand each other. So that's why this comes in. This is Open Geospatial Consortium. So they set the standards for all of the products like WebMap server, WebMap tile server, but yeah, we'll talk about WebMap server. And this is the link to the PDF in which they define everything. We'll go, but we'll not be going through details here. I'll be talking about some points, but uh, Okay, I'll be talking about some stuff. We'll check on that later. So first of all is get capabilities. So this is where you are a web map client, you go to the web map server, you want to check what kind of layers does it provide, what kind of coordinate reference system does it use, or are there many, can you use all of them? So all of this stuff is done I'll talk about this later. But yeah, let's go to this kind of request. Okay, so I have set up a local web map server in my local host, and check this out. So you see each layer has their name, SRS in which they are represented, lat long bounding box, and there are times, I guess. Yeah, there are times, the starting time and end time. So this is, I talked about a 3D data set, right? Or rather 4D. You have time and you have height. So you have to specify everything and then you get an image. So this is, So that's about what kind of stuff are there in get capabilities. And then we'll talk about the next set of requests or next kind of request. Get map. So get map is the first request we made to another web map server, and this is the demo URL for get map. But we have seen this earlier, and yeah, we get the data which we saw. Like that's one of the layers it provides. I've selected the first layer, and this is the kind of data we get. Just so that the web map server is deployed properly, we'll check. We'll let's say change the coordinate. Yeah. So yeah, we'll skip this layer, we'll skip this demo for now, but my point was, we can do all of the modifications and we'll still get different maps and get VSAG map. This is for the vertical layer which I talked about, or the side view layer. This is a vertical section of the cloud cover in an area, and you can see that, it's a small difference, but yeah, you can check it out that the elevation in which the cloud cover like increases is different for that side and less for here. And we demoed a WMS with GIS client. If we have time, we'll do it more. And okay, how does Python fare in this sector? And why should, okay, first of all, why should one need Python to develop WMS? Because first of all, it's easy. It's a language, it's pretty easy. It's like plain English, but powerful. Why not? And second is extensible. Since most of the research or some of the production stuff are done in Python, why not make the code base, homogeneous and write it to Python? So that's why we can use Python to develop this. And why should you contribute? Because you're using maps every day, all the time. You should give back. And how can you contribute? And so OGC is the, these are all links. You can go check the slides. And these are all links. And OGC is the repository which is used to set the standards. You can raise issue and tell them stuff, changes to make. Basemap is this, the library which I talked about, which you use to develop maps, and Cartopy is the improved one. MSS is something which I personally work on. It involves a web map server and a client and other add-ons, but yeah, if you want, you can check that out. To understand WMS, I use this. You can also come by and check. MetPy is Meteorology Python. It's also one of the repositories which use atmospheric, GIS. And OpenStreetMap, this is the best one. You can, even if you don't want to code, you can just contribute geographical data to OpenStreetMap and they'll be happy. Yeah, so thanks. That's about my talk. Thanks for attending. And this is my Twitter handle, this is email. I'm open to questions.
All right, show of hand for questions.
Can we do a question?
Okay.
Hi. Thanks for the session. A question, I want the latitude longitude of all the places on this world.
Okay.
Apart from Google Maps, which provider provides this? This open, whatever you told this, openspatial.org.
Okay.
Because, I want to implement, the challenge here is Google has made their APIs, chargeable.
Okay.
Since last year.
Yeah.
So I'm not finding any other alternates to get all the coordinates.
The best alternative is OpenStreetMap. They have a lot of different terrain and different CRS which I talked about. So OpenStreetMap would be the thing to go to for this. There are other alternatives, or there are libraries which work on top of OpenStreetMap, but that'll be the best of.
Hi. My name is Gokul.
Yeah.
I want to know, how do you consume the maps here? Like, if it is a web thing, you can use Leaflet, or you can use OpenStreetMaps itself to consume the map data.
Mm-hmm.
So in Python, is there any library that you're using to consume the maps?
Yeah, I mean, so that's OpenStreetMap, the visualizer OpenStreetMap, or the Google Street, Google Earth, all of these are map clients, right? You have map clients in Python as well. And if you want to check out, I linked it to MSS. I'll be posting this on Twitter later, the slides. But yeah, my point is, we have an open implementation of client inside MSS, and there are others as well. And but my point is, that's not different, no? As in, this is coded in JavaScript, that's coded in Python. Since desktop versions are not used nowadays, as in to consume any type of data, we're using a browser or something. So if you want, there are already implementations. Check MSS out. And there are others as well. Check for, I personally use MSS, but check others out too. There, I'm sure.
Any more questions? Any more questions from the audience? Okay, so I guess we'll end the session here.
Yeah.
Thank you, Shivashis.
Yeah. Thanks for attending.